Good evening, everyone. I'm Jan Bell Jan, golf course architect. And here's the design team. So I'm a member of the American Society of Golf Course Architects, and those people who you've seen wearing this plaid jacket, they're also members, and there are some others. Michael Beebe, I'm also a registered Florida landscape architect. I'm an International Society of Arboriculture certified arborist, and I am a State of Florida Woman Business certified. Michael Beebe here is also a member of the American Society of Golf Course Architect, registered landscape architect, and he is my partner in this project. Robert Higgins is a civil engineer, and he's currently doing the work on the new Michael Jordan project up in Hope Sound. Brian Idle, who you may remember from a previous event, is our clubhouse architect. Michael Heidman, the general contractor, is our design build golf course maintenance specialist. And Sean Heide is our irrigation designer. He is also has a degree in landscape architecture from the University of Florida, and he's been doing this work for quite a long time. So what we discovered was that Greater Bukitan Beach and Park District has a mission, and it is conservation, education, recreation. And this team was assembled to meet that mission. We have a vision for the golf course, and part of that vision entails something like what you would see here, an integration of the natural environment, long, smooth, flowing contours, maybe not quite so many bunkers, but a very pleasantly framed golf course with multiple sets of tees. Oops, there. So that and there are some behind, so this would truly meet the needs of, I would say, 98% of your players, except the extreme novices. They might not find that they would have par all the time, but they also wouldn't expect to have that anyway. So, our vision includes this. If this is a community center, this is not just a golf course. This is a community center with recreation experiences beyond golf. And we will design it holistically, thinking about this in its entirety, not just the golf course, but other parts of the community that should be served here. Designed, built, and maintained to sustain the project both economically and environmentally. This should be self-sustaining in many ways. So this is our vision. We expect that we would hear from the town hall meetings that these might be some of the things that we would hear that the golfers would want. Fair and consistent playing surface. Everybody here who plays golf, that's exactly what you want. You want it to be consistent, and one of the ways we'll do that, we will have a single stand of grass, a monoculture of grass, which also will help with the maintenance of things. You don't have edging, minimizes some of the effort that you have to put out, both in equipment and in labor. This is probably the most difficult one, challenging the expert golfer, but fair and fun for everybody else. You have two golf teams here from the universities, Lynn and FAU, and then you have assorted high school teams. You want to challenge them. You expect them to be able to progress and go on and represent the Boca area in the best way they can because they're good players. We can design a golf course that will make that possible in ways that other people haven't even thought about, but then still make it fun and fair for all. The local natural environment and landscape. Right now on the golf course, there's a lot of invasive species, but there are still a lot of beautiful, beautiful mature live oaks that should be preserved and enhanced and maybe even moved if they need to be moved to protect them. Good value for conditions provided. This is essential. Desirable pace of play. How many of you have been in traffic and you sit and you wait? And if you took another route, but you were moving, you'd get there at the same time, but you'd feel better if you're moving. Well, the same thing can happen on a golf course. We can set up a pace of play so that even though the same amount of time, whether it's a 4-hour round for 9 or for 18 or 2 hours for 9, we would still have a good pace of play. People wouldn't feel like they waited. Positive perception in the community.
Yeah, these last two we think are important. Obviously, since the golf course is closed, you know, the dynamics of that community, the surrounding residential has changed a lot because of the golf course being closed. we think it's very important to kind of stimulate the that surrounding area again with this project to give us an opportunity to revitalize that area. That's important. The other thing is, it's obviously important that the business model works financially. So what we've done is, you know, we've looked at your NGF report that was prepared for you. We've kind of used that as our model and our guideline, and then we've done some of our own market research and to confirm some of the things that we felt and that the NGF report has also recommended. So you know, we feel pretty good about that. We'll continue to drill down into that a little bit more as we continue to talk tonight. But those things are very important to us and part of that vision that Jan mentioned.
So among the things that were recommended in the NGF report was 27 holes. We concur with that. We did our research and we find that 27 holes work beautifully. However, we can make this each of those nines play as par three or executive style because of the way we set up the tee locations. And it's important to understand that it can be programmed out of your golf shop by talented people who understand how golf courses really work to play as a par three or an executive course as well as full-length golf courses. So you have a little better understanding. My father and my five uncles were all club professionals. My dad designed and supervised the construction of the golf course where I grew up. I started working on a golf course when I was 14. I was mowing greens, seeds, fairways, digging ditches, raking bunkers, obviously in the summers and on weekends. But I learned a lot there. I was an assistant golf course superintendent. You know, when my dad had the golf shop, because he was the pro and the superintendent, if we didn't have people come to play, we didn't have success. Part of the revenue, part of his income was what he sold the golf shop if he had lessons. If the golf course wasn't fun, people didn't come, we didn't eat. We ate, so I'm here. So that's the good news. So all that by way of saying, I understand from the very basic part of golf course operations what it takes to manage a golf course and to have set it up so that people can have fun. The practice range is an obvious. We believe there's a short game area that's important, and a putting course, which could be a half to a full acre, and then a par two course, which we'll elaborate on, which I think. So on our 27 holes of golf, this is a course that I worked on 20 years ago. This is called the Old Collier Golf Club in Naples, Florida. It was a 2003 winner of the State of Florida Environmental Award. This is Seashore Pass Pound. It's a monostand of golf, golf course turf. So it looks like this all the time. The grass has been there for 20 years and it's been maintained beautifully. But you can see again the nice sweeping contours, and you were right, it's
very touchy.
So nice sweeping contours with accents, and but you can see it's open, it's very inviting to play, and these are the kinds of things we're looking for, is the test for everybody will be visible from whatever set of markers they play. On that course, this is probably one of the most important things. This is a concept that I developed myself and that has been now spreading throughout the country. It's called scoring tees. For those of you, can you all read this back there? I'll read it for you. A note on the evolution of scoring tees at Pelican's Nest. As an innovative golf course design, the scoring tees were met with some skepticism by club members. Through her collaborative relationship with the club's golf pro, Ms. Beljan, assisted in communicating to the members the unique benefits of scoring tees for golfers. Today, scoring tees are regularly used by both low and high handicap golfers. We regard them as an excellent additions to our courses, and that's Dr. Ed Milliken, chairman of the Green Committee, when the course was under construction. I did 36 holes there. So the scoring tees, and if you can see from back there up in the center of the image, are two guys, and those happen to be the golf professionals. And that's at the scoring tee. You can see there's markers here for five other sets of markers. There's two more behind from where this picture was taken. So the length of the golf holes is pretty dramatic. The entire golf course from the tips is 6903. From the scoring tees is 4062. The important part about that is that now we have a course, when the head golf professional first played this golf course, He played on Sunday. He shot 72 from 68-50. The next two days later on Tuesday, he was 3 over from 4,062 yards. And he said, I learned something. I learned what I need to know, which is my short game. So by him doing that, and you can see the golf pros here playing from there, and this is on New Year's Day, because everybody on New Year's Eve, they may not be ready for a full round the next day. And so this was Beat the Pro Day. The men and the women all played from the same set of markers, as well as the pros, and their handicaps are involved. These courses are rated by the USGA for both men and women. There's a separate scorecard. So this, the beauty of the scoring tees is it suits the best players. Collegiate coaches send out their players at least once a week and have them play from those forward set of markers. Why do they do that? They're long hitters. They should be back there. Wrong. It's because it teaches them course management. It teaches them where to position the ball so they can have a short shot. How do they learn their short game? Then it also teaches them to go low. If they shoot a 62, nobody's going to say from what set of markers, right? So to that end, the players here at Pelican's Nest, at the Pelican Marsh, Jupiter Island Club, and another property that I'm working on now, all have scoring tees, and they're being used very effectively, not just by the people with slow club head speeds, people who hit the ball just a short distance, juniors, seniors, a lot of women, a lot of novice players, but it's used by everybody. So the tees, as you can tell, the important part is they're formal. And that's important because it shows respect to the people that you say you want to be there. They're welcoming, they're respected. They're not a set of markers out in the middle of a fairway that said, oh, it's okay you came here, just go up there and hit. You know, you're not good enough to have a formal set of tees. This says we welcome you, we respect you, we want you, we encourage you to play. And that says it to all those people who are sometimes denied that opportunity. And as important as all of that is, this is a set of tees that will always accommodate people with disabilities. They don't have to play from there, but they can always play from there because they'll always be accessible, right? There are many people, they're actually talking about a tour now for people with disabilities, but they have to kind of sort out everything. I've been on the board for the National Alliance for Accessible Golf for 10 years, and prior to that, I was one of the people who was providing input to the Department of Justice on how golf for people with disabilities. So I've kind of been in that arena. The other thing is, when from these tees like this, imagine what you can do with juniors. Juniors can bring their parents. Parents can take their kids. Now everybody can play from the same set of markers. Another thing we have an opportunity for is a short game area. And you can see a short game area like this is pretty well used. But we could do things like this and put in some actual artificial turf at places where so that the areas don't get too beat up. And if this is a short game area like this with the kind of popularity it could have, that could happen. So we could account and adjust for that. So you ask, what was the par two course? Here it is. Anybody here been up to Port St. Lucie, PGA Village? All right, so those of you who have, you may know that this is Perfect Drive right there, parking lot. And there's a six-hole course right here. This is free. And I would say the same thing would happen here. Your community deserves to have golf that's free for everybody. This is only 10,000 square feet. And we could have six holes here. You bring out a little chipping wedge, and these greens are probably 1,500 square feet. Again, this is all seashore past Pelham. It's all the same turf type. So there's nothing extraordinary that has to be done as far as edging. It's only the mowing pattern. But this is the kind of thing you can have that really makes a difference to your community, that brings everybody into the game, whether they play it or not. This is their first taste. They have fun here. Let's go on to the short game area. Let's go on to get some lessons, go on to the scoring tees. And next thing you know, we're ready to play full-length golf course. So again, from a par two course, very family friendly. You can have children this young being able to walk. They're only walking 1,000 feet one way up, you know, up and back. This is certain they're capable of doing this. Even if it takes them two or three to get on those short little holes, they can do it. They feel success. And that's the important part, is we want people to feel successful here. People who feel success with what they do, continue to do whatever that is. And if it's golf, we'll have more people come here because they'll feel successful there, have fun. And it's not that it's going to be easy, because the strategy has to be there. So again, as I said, this is not just for, you know, this is for everybody in your community. It's for people in Special Olympics, it is people, it's our Wounded Warriors, it's our, you know, Folds of Honor. The golf course is accessible to everyone. It's barrier free. We've got environmental programs that could be done on the golf course, and that would be with the plant materials, as well as understanding how water moves and drains. Bird boxes as tee markers. This is, happens to be a special event, but these are the kinds of things that you could do. Teach about birds on the golf course. And once you have a population, once you have different trees out here that feed the birds differently, whether it's nuts or whether it's pollen or berries, you'll have more insects, more butterflies, more bees. You'll have birds, you'll have wildlife to talk about that isn't them. So we have the non-turf areas, native and Florida-friendly plants, remove invasive exotics, add pollinating gardens, bioswales, and rain gardens. All of these things work in seamlessly into the golf course. And guidance on plant management. Too many times you have a landscape architect, they can do pretty work, but then somebody attacks the plants and they start doing things that are needless. It's just a waste of money and a waste of time. So this is native, all native plant materials here. Dahoon holly, sunshine mimosa, very deep-rooted round cover, and spike rush, which is very encouraging to wading birds. And then you have other pollinators, if you didn't know it. Birds and butterflies like the flowers that are in the yellow and the red spectrum. Bees like things in the blue spectrum because they're colorblind. They see red as black, so you will see them go more toward other kinds of plants. So all of those, I think about those things. I want to know what the pH of the soil is. I want to know what the exposure is. All of these plants were chosen to put here. All these iris are here because those are locally planted, because we know what the conditions are. This was a photograph in the Golf Journal, year 2000. USGA did this. All these flags, really why this picture's here. I put out 2,200 flags, 2,000 flags for shrubs, 22 for trees, and 10,000 for herbs, wildflowers, other grasses, and it's all on the ground. This isn't just a painting that says, okay, like I'll get my quantities, but then everything is very site-specifically located, so that by the time I'm done, and there's people in this room who know, you can't tell where God stopped and I started. That's the plan, you know, so that it's seamless when it's done. So we have here, you know, we're looking at an osprey with a snake, and we've got a roseate spiegel up here, and we've got a great blue heron, and these are the kinds of animals that you could have on your golf course. And, you know, important to have snags, too. So pollinators on golf courses where I go, I do pollinator gardens. So we encourage that. Irrigation, prescriptive stormwater harvesting with lakes and cisterns. People underestimate some space that's available for cisterns, and I think Brian and Mike will talk a little more about that. Don't do this. Let's control where we put the water. This is all organized, so this is the weather monitoring station, so we know how much to put out and when. When you have littoral shelves, this is what you have. All these wading birds here eating the crustaceans and the reptiles and amphibians that are right here on the edge. Maintenance building. Come up here and help us out, Mike.
Good evening. My name is Mike Heidman. I'm with Eagle Design Build. My firm specializes in the design and construction of economical, functional, and environmentally friendly maintenance facilities for golf courses. We work directly hand-in-hand with the golf course architects to properly position the maintenance facility to maximize the efficiency of the staff. We then position the buildings on property to maximize the flow of traffic, equipment, and other functions of the maintenance facility. What we've discussed here for your property is the option of solar power. The industry is moving towards solar power. Municipalities are moving towards solar power. And as a resident of a golf course and a property such that you have here that is flanked by residential property, it's invaluable to look at the possibility of electric power for your machines to minimize the noise. And so when we get into the maintenance area and we start positioning buildings, we'll maximize the potential for the sun. There's some other design concepts that we bring into the maintenance area. There's some major liabilities that as an owner of a golf course you have for fuel storage, equipment washing, fertilizer storage, and chemical mixed load and storage. It's all mandated by the state of Florida. The state of Florida got very proactive in the mid-1990s and used our facilities as a basis for their best management practices. That booklet has now been reproduced 3 different times by the state, and the state is currently working with the USGA on a program called 50 by 20, where the state of Florida, through the partnership with the University of Florida, is developing a best management practices to be used throughout the United States for maintenance facilities, for golf courses, to minimize the impact on the environment. Another item that we incorporate into the maintenance facility is collecting and reusing the wash water that's used to wash the equipment. A general 18-hole golf course will use between 180,000 and 300,000 gallons of water annually washing off the equipment. If that water is allowed to go into a storm system and into a body of water, you're now in violation with the state of Florida and the federal government. So we incorporate a wash system that collects that water, it filters that water, it cleans that water, and it reuses that water so that it's used again over and over on a daily basis. This is a model facility. This is actually a facility that we built in Orlando. By positioning the buildings as such, the general access into the facility for the staff comes in here. We position the parking lot as such so that you don't have traffic going around the facility. The staff comes into the building. They have a nice office area here. It shows the staff that you appreciate them and that you know, when it comes to a property and you've got a golf course and you've got a country club, and you've got all this turf that you want to look nice, we look at the maintenance facility. You know, if you look at the property as a human body, we look at the maintenance facility as the heart. And without the heart, you don't have anything else. So we like to provide a functional maintenance facility for the staff, because ultimately, it's the 30 guys working out of here that are going to keep your property top notch. Here's an example of solar power on a facility. This facility here invested in solar power. It is used to recharge their entire fleet of golf carts, as well as some of the additional maintenance equipment that they're phasing into their operation.
And what they probably use about 90%, so they only pay about 10%. If they made any more, they can sell it back to the utility.
Consistent with Jan and Mike's vision for environmental awareness, just wanted to let you know that our emphasis on this project is LEED certification. As far as I know, the only private club that in South Florida that has received LEED certification is the Broken Sound Club right here in Boca, and we had designed that. So these are some of the attributes, part of it is harvesting water. Go back one slide. We're missing a slide. Okay, all right. And the Broken Sand Club is an example of what we would bring to this project in LEED certification. And like I said, a part of it is harvesting the water, using cisterns, displacing soil to be used out on the golf course, and then using that water in the irrigation system. We are down to 2 minutes.
So, you know, when we get into community access, that what goes beyond the golf, we've got the walk trail around the course perimeter as possible, a 3-mile-plus loop around the west side, maybe a 2-mile-plus on the east side, one or both. Kids playground and park should be there, a golf fitness apparatus should be right there with it, and community gardens are a possibility. Then there's alternate uses for some of the golf areas, movies, concert, camping. So here's an idea. Look at the adult fitness apparatus here, and you can see the background playground equipment for the kids. Very beautifully can be integrated with a par two course, one next to the other. You can see how much use the people would enjoy this. Community gardens, you could do something like this and have some of them raised a little bit higher for access by people with disabilities, people who might be in wheelchairs. And then, of course, with all the pollination, pollinator plant materials that I put out there, I've had people put bees, they have beekeepers come and they make them harvest their own honey. So with all of these principles and values, this is beyond a golf course. This is a golf park. So it could be a model for other cities and municipalities. Any questions?
See, yeah, one quick question. First of all, I'm very impressed with some of the ideas that you have.
Thank you.
They are definitely thinking out of the box. Insofar as some of the extras that you want to put on a house, this is going to affect the possibility of tournament play on this course?
Well, I don't know what you mean.
In other words, will the course, the three nines, what, if you took 18, excuse me, took 18 holes, would the course be big enough for tournament play?
Well, the 18 would be all on the west side. It makes no sense to have 16 holes on this side and cross over
right.
to two. It makes no sense. So if it's meant to accommodate a tournament, then we need to know that, and then we would design accordingly. So that just needs to be part of the criteria. Up to this point, there was no mention of that. But if that's part of the criteria, because we're also talking about crowds, we're talking about concessions, we're talking about moving people around to gain access to all of those places, there's a lot of different thought processes that go into that that still make it on the other 51 weeks of the year very playable, and people don't know until there's a place. You have to have level enough areas for the grandstands, and for, you know, there's just a lot of things to think about, but mm-hmm. that could be accommodated.
Sure. Okay. Thank you.
Sure,
Welcome.
Yes, ma'am.
I'll probably take your question.
So the 27 holes, really what you're saying is, and we're looking for the best design, so does that,
sure.
You're saying it's not 27 holes, it's really 18, and then you do all these other things.
No, I'm saying there's 18 holes on the west side, 9 holes on the east side of the road.
Right.
Right?
But how do you get the 6 and all that in there?
Oh, how do you get the 6? Because you have, it's the routing for one thing, but it's also every golf hole has a range in distance, so that the shortest tee, if somebody hits a ball only 130 yards off the tee as a drive, that's different than somebody who hits it 250, right? So we set it up so that the person who hits it 130, their tee shot lands closer to the green, but they're still going to be using a similar club into the green as the guy who hits it much further. So the landing areas are different.
And I think the other thing that you're asking is that footprint for the par two course or for the putting course, very small, it's 10,000
yeah.
square feet. So we feel like in the overall property, there's enough room to put those additional alternative type golf facilities, the par two, you know, the
with the driving range,
with all that, yes, yeah. So we think there's enough room to fit those in there. So I hope that gets to the core of what you're asking.
In the same spirit, though, I mean, I love the environmental and the things that you brought to the table, which I think are great. But given the investment the district and everyone is putting into it, do you have any thoughts to when the sun goes down, is this thing over? Or is there anything more we can do to really bring in revenue to support the whole thing? Is that may need lighted driving range or not? What's your thoughts on that?
If you can do a lighted driving range. We didn't put it. I know that was one of the things that was mentioned in the NGF study. But I think it's making sure that we, you know, from a light pollution standpoint, that's one thing. And the other thing is the neighbors. Mm-hmm. So there is lighting now that is kind of up lighting that's not as direct, so that you don't have to have the poles, which are usually expensive. There's a lot of new kinds of lighting now that could be used to have a lighted, an evening lighted range. Sure. and to have that operational through, you know, in the winter till 9 o'clock at night. You have somebody, and it doesn't have to be necessarily staffed, just somebody to turn off the lights, but it's on a timer, as long as you have vending machine for balls, and then of course having a rest station there, I think, for a comfort station.
And some of it's programming, too.
Yes.
You could program some nighttime events, you know, not maybe on a daily basis, but you could program some of the things that you saw up there, movie night, concert on the green night, camping, you know. So there is some programming things you could do to meet some of those needs that you talked about.
So it's the golf needs, but it's also the community needs. I mean, I think there's ways to do this, and a lot of it involves people who know how to program, who understand the asset that you have, and who make the most of it.
Yeah, time for one more question. Eric,
please. That was my one main question, but I was wondering how you were going to fill that in. But I love the idea of a walk trail, if that's something that would be actually possible in terms of liability, I guess, for the golf course.
Some of it's programming, and again, it's that walk at your own risk. At certain times, it's walk at your own risk, and I think there are signings that declare that, mm-hmm. you know, and not in just one place, because of course I didn't see it because
right.
I was doing that, right?
No, I love the adult fitness apparatus, fantastic. And then I love that you guys mentioned the lead for the clubhouse and the solar power. I think you guys have been the first ones to mention that, maybe one more, but not many have mentioned it.
Thank you everyone for your time. Really appreciate the opportunity to have been here. Thank you so much.